We request the people at the back to come forward so we'd be more close together. Kunti pang forward, hindi kami nangangagat.
Sure.
Nang babata pa lang, joke lang. Okay, good afternoon everyone. Thank you for coming. So this is, I think, the 2nd in November in our special seminar series of the Crop Science Cluster. We have homegrown then from the UPLB as our speaker, but he will be introduced later by our chair person. May I call on now, Ms. Dr. Aminan to introduce our speaker.
Magandang hapon sa lahat. It's a pleasure to introduce a batchmate. And I'm really glad to welcome you back. Because after a very colorful and excellent, and I think stellar career track, he's back to serve the Philippines in a very big way. So Dr. Lali Higag is our batch summa cum laude. And if I remember vividly, he had a GPA of 1.04 for many years, and I think hindi pa na-break. Kung niya tayong ginto sa kataasan sa lahat ng GPA ng Los Baños. So, but he finished it in 3 years as an INTAP scholar and taught for a year at Bio. He's a genetics major.
Cell
major, but took up the PhD degree, no? Straight to the U.S. at Yale. Okay. So PhD in molecular biophysics and biochemistry. So after that, he pursued genetics at the Harvard Medical School. And he had interest in patenting when he entered DuPont, no? As a patent liaison in agricultural biotech division for the Harvard field. So after that, he pursued law degree, no, in Juris Doctor degree at Harvard Law School. Kita nyo naman yung mga pinasupan ng institusyon. Sino kaya sa inyong makakatulad? Makakatungtong man lang sa mga ilan ng pinuntungan. No, so, isa siya sa mga kaunting tao sa mundo na may PhD na may JD pa. After that, he was employed as a patent attorney for a law firm in Finnegan Anderson for several years and practiced which was focused on patent litigation in the biopharmaceutical arts. So this was how he was introduced at the big scientist, as a big scientist grantee of BOST, because he came back in 2014, you know, to do many work, you know, to promote, to help the Philippines in many research and development aspects. So after, with his Balik Scientist team, he was engaged with the Philippine Genome Center, the UPLB Center for Technology Transfer Entrepreneurship at the UST, where he advised faculty, researchers, administrators, and students on issues related to patent law and as applied to their research. So currently, he is back and he's more active as the deputy chief of party of the RTI International team that is implementing the STRIDE program of the U.S. Agency for International Development. So I'd really be glad to hear him share his experience, because innovation is something that the Philippines need, no, in many aspects of our life, especially with the challenges of the times. So let's give our big hand to Dr. Lawrence Ida.
Thank you, Amy, for the kind introduction. So, like Amy mentioned, I am an LB native. I spent my childhood here. Where I was born in the States when my parents were getting their PhDs at Purdue. And then when I was 2 years old, we went back to the Philippines. And but I don't remember any of that. So I don't know if you've heard of the ADEX compound. So that's along Silangan Street which is now VMLS Street. So that's where the St. Teresa's Church is located. So that's where I grew up. And that's also where I live nowadays during weekends. I currently work in Makati as part of the team implementing the USAID-funded STRIKE project. So our office is in Makati. I work in Makati during the week. And then on the weekends, I come here, take the bus, and stay with my mom. So that's pretty much my schedule these days. So I mentioned the STRIKE project, and that is what I am going to talk about for a portion of my presentation. But before that, I think Amy requested that I talk about my background, so, and also discuss how my LD experience shaped my career path. So I was born in the States, and then so I don't have any memories of my 2 years in the States, but what my first memories are about LD, about living in Sudan Street. So that's a picture of me. That's me in the middle. So that's taken 7 years ago. So evidence that I grew up here. Okay. So those are my parents, my mom, my dad. So they were teachers here in LD also. My mom was a professor in plant pathology. She's since retired. And my dad was a professor in economics. He's passed on. That's my younger brother, Paul, who we all took up biology here in LB, but we've taken up different tracks. My younger brother, Paul, is now a faculty in University of Stockholm in Sweden. My sister, older sister, or only sister, is she became a doctor, and she's now a clinical researcher at Eli Lilly sa Indianapolis, Indiana. And then my big brother Vic is in biotech companies all over in Australia, also engaged also here in the Philippines. So I went to Makiling Elementary School, the rural high school when it was still across St. Therese, but now it's in Bae, and I think it's now math department yata yung rural. That was where I previously. So I went to UPLD for college. I took up biology, majoring in cell biology. I did my thesis at IPB. So I am an alumnus of IPB, and I get invited to a number of their activities. So as far as I can remember, I've always been fascinated by life. Okay, and what makes us and all the animals and plants and microbes able to live. So research in biology was a career option for me. A BS in biology from UPLB was certainly a step in the right direction, and I could follow that up with a PhD in the biological sciences. So my mom was suggesting maybe I wanted to be a doctor, but I had this impression that a medical doctor's life would be too much stress for me, where a simple mistake can lead to serious injury or death to a patient. And my friends will tell you that I go for less stress. So medicine was not really for me. I wasn't going to grad school directly from undergrad though. And as Amy mentioned, I needed a break from studying. And so I taught for a year here at UPLB at the Institute of Biological Sciences. So that was a great experience, giving me an opportunity to mature a bit, work for a living, explore my career options, and interact with students, faculty, and staff as an instructor. So after a year, I went to Yale to pursue a PhD in molecular biophysics and biochemistry. So why Yale? So I thought that would be like hitting two birds with one stone, if you will. So one of the reasons I was interested in pursuing grad studies in the US was to learn more about US history and culture in an informal setting. And I thought one way of going about that was studying in one of the older institutions of higher learning in the U.S. I did apply to Harvard, but they didn't want me. Of course, maybe it didn't help that I applied to one of the most competitive biological departments there. In any event, I had a productive time at Yale. Okay, my research related to the molecular biology of chlorophyll biosynthesis. So I cloned a gene encoding an enzyme early on in the pathway, and I characterized its expression patterns. So the experimental system I used was Arabidopsis thaliana, which was the model system being developed at the time for plant studies because of its short generation time, relatively small genome size, and small stature. So maliitra. So you can grow nuts in a small space, which is great for genetics studies, and preparing raw material for extraction studies. I also got to work with Arabidopsis protoplasts to study auxin regulation using reporter genes. So these are protoplasts, just plant cells with a cell wall degraded, and they're still metabolically active, and you can insert things into it and then study the effect of that by extracting or by disintegrating them and then studying the extracts that you get from the protoplast. So after a PhD, you normally do a postdoc in order to eventually land a faculty tenure track position. So I did about a year of postdoc at Yale, continuing my research. And I also got to spend a month at Cambridge doing research on a different part of the chlorophyll biosynthetic pathway. Then I was off to Harvard Medical School to do a full-fledged postdoc research fellowship. So I spent the postdoc in a lab that was in the forefront of elucidating at the molecular level the basis of the specificity of plant disease resistance of plant-host pathogen interactions. So actually, the lab was located at Massachusetts General Hospital. So it's a hospital, right? But there would be ground greenhouses in one at the top of one of the buildings. So at first blush, it might seem strange for a hospital to be doing plant research. Turns out, though, that plants and animals have a lot in common. For example, the factors that make a microorganism pathogenic to plant are the same factors, or at least some of them are, that make a microorganism pathogenic to a human. So doing the experiments in plants was a very expeditious way to understand pathogenicity affecting humans. So I tried to extend the findings of the lab where I worked in regarding plant disease resistance to rice and isolate disease resistance genes. And so I spent part of the fellowship at Erie. Okay, my stint at Erie at the time was also in a way for me to test whether I could actually settle here and do research, and settle here for good to do research. Eventually, I decided to go back to the States. So at that point, I was actually reconsidering my decision to pursue a career in research. I found research a bit frustrating and for plant experiments to take too much time to get results. So maybe I was feeling a bit burned out as well, working on weekends and thinking about plan B and plan C experiments all the time in case plan A experiments didn't pan out. So I also had other interests as well. So in the end, I seriously considered alternative career options that would still make use of my technical background. So there was biocomputing, so I took a programming course at Washtenaw Community College in Michigan. So that's Washtenaw Community College, where I was staying with my sisters, with my sister in between jobs. But ultimately, I ended up as a patent liaison at DuPont Agricultural Products in Delaware. So as a patent liaison, you act as a conduit between the scientist and the patent lawyer, so that the patent application for the research or invention describes the technology appropriately, and at the same time satisfies the legal requirements. I got to work with scientists and lawyers, draft patent applications, and prepare responses defending the patent applications before the patent office. So it was a job I really liked, and a job where you also got, where you also get to be creative. So the next step for me was to go to law school to become a full-fledged patent attorney. So I went to law school, this time at Harvard Law School. I was in my 30s, and most of my classmates were fresh college graduates. And most of my classmates were really smart, so it was intimidating and at the same time inspiring. I already had friends in the area, in Boston, Massachusetts, from my postdoc years. So it was great to be able to leave the stress of law school, come Friday, and spend at least part of the weekend with friends away from school. So the great thing of going to law school later in life was having a real definite idea of what you want to do with a law degree, instead of law school being a default option, like for fresh college graduates who did not know what to do career-wise. So after law school, I went to DC to work in a law firm for the next several years. My practice mainly focused on patent litigation, that is court cases dealing with patent issues, like patent infringement, validity, enforceability. The patents at issue in the cases were pharmaceutical or biotechnological in nature, so my technical background came in handy. To be good on the job, you have to be detail-oriented, creative, and have a never-give-up attitude and be a team player. Things I were into, so the job suited me well. But all things come to an end, and last year, as Amy mentioned, I thought it was time to come back to the Philippines and see what I can do here. So I became a balik scientist under the TOST program early last year and worked part of my time here at UPLB in the Center for Technology Transfer and Entrepreneurship and the Philippine Genome Center, mainly as a resource person on patent issues. Then a few months later, I became part of the STRIDE program. So looking back at my career trajectory so far, it might look like I've been bouncing around with no direction. That might actually be true, but running through it all is a connection to science and technology. There were my postdoc stints with an obvious tie up to research. My patent jobs were about learning the technology and developing the best way to protect it. And now my administrative post at STRIDE is about promoting innovation in science and technology. Of course, all this started with my undergrad studies here at UPLB. And my time here at LD gave me the confidence to explore areas I found interesting. So this brings me to my present job. So as previously mentioned, I am part of the team implementing the STRIDE program. So STRIDE, as you know, as is shown in all the slides I've been showing, stands for Science, Technology, Research, and Innovation for Development. So we're all about improving science and technology research here in the Philippines and spurring innovation and economic growth. As you can imagine, it is a significant challenge. We hear innovations all the time, and I'm sure we all have our own definitions. But common to all these definitions, I would like to believe, are the elements of creativity, originality, and non-obviousness that need to be present for something to be called an innovation. So the challenge is, how do you create a culture of innovation here in the Philippines? Culture, by definition, is something that is second nature and developed over time. So we at STRIDE can only plant seeds, and time will tell if these seeds do grow and become the basis for a culture of innovation. So STRIDE is a five-year program with a relatively big budget. So we are able to implement a number of things. Okay, innovation does not happen in a vacuum. Innovative ideas usually build on previous knowledge or ideas of other people. Collaboration can therefore catalyze innovation, because when a number of people work on a project, they sound ideas off each other, and usually with this exchange of ideas, sparks fly, and you as a group collectively come up with ideas to test. So a keystone of most of our activities under STRIDE is collaboration or networking. The research grants we give out, for example, has a collaboration component, either with a U.S. university or a Philippine industry partner. This need for collaboration appears to be something that the national government is encouraging. So a few weeks ago, I attended the CHED Second National Research Conference, and there I found that CHED is encouraging upper-tier HEIs to collaborate with lower-tier HEIs. I think this is a step in the right direction, especially when resources are scarce and we have to do with the limited resources. In addition, CHED is also interested in the idea of awarding research grants that involve collaboration with an industry partner, just like the STRIDE grants. So going back to the STRIDE research grants, there is also a requirement that the research be linked to economic growth, which means that the research addresses a market need. I think this is an important point because we are finding out that a substantial amount of research being done is technology driven, meaning they do the research because they can and because that's what other people are doing. It's hard for that kind of research to be innovative because for something to be considered innovative, it has to be adopted to some degree by a considerable segment of the population and solves a long-felt need. And it's not going to happen if the research does not address a market need and the research is performed just because you know how to do the research. So then we discussed some of the projects that STRIDE has funded to give you a flavor of the things that we think will spur innovation here in the Philippines. So the first project is here from UPLB, from Dr. Lilia Fernando's group at Biotech. So this basically builds on the previous research of Dr. Fernando here at UPLB at Biotech. So she previously discovered that local isolates of plant growth promoting bacteria have the ability to produce gold nanoparticles, which are important in fabricating materials for use in medical diagnostics and drug delivery. Okay, now she wants to determine how the bacteria are able to do it at the molecular level. And if she is successful, she will be able to identify the enzyme involved in the process of making gold nanoparticles and try to mass produce or overexpress the enzyme and make the process of making nanoparticles less expensive and more environment friendly. She's collaborating with faculty member in Southern Illinois University, who is an expert in the molecular genetic methods she will be using. UPLB, under this project, will also work with Batangas State University in incorporating nanotechnology topics in the course curricula offered at Batangas State University. And there's this project from UP Diliman on the production of halimenya. This is being implemented by Dr. Trono in UP Diliman in collaboration with Plentex Corporation, which is interested in building an integrated fish feed production facility in the Leyte Sabar region. So Dr. Trono is testing on a pilot scale level the protocol he has developed for mass producing halimenya. So halimenya is a red seaweed from which high-value products can be extracted, including lambda-carrageenan and the pigments phycoerythrin and phycocyanin. Okay, lambda-carrageenan is a food additive to get the melt-in-your-mouth type of consistency, whereas the pigments extracted can be used as natural food colorants or dyes or laboratory reagents. So if the experiments are successful, that would be one step closer for the technology to be adopted by Plentex and also by Fisher Folk, who can use the technology to grow and sell halimenya, providing an additional source of income. A related project is being implemented by Dr. Montano, also of UP Diliman, which relates to the actual extraction of the high-value carrageenan and pigments from halimenya grown by Dr. Trono, to see if they can develop extraction methods that make economic sense. Okay, this project comes from Western Philippine University in Palawan. They are developing protocols to efficiently produce abalone juveniles, you know, the small mini abalones, which will then be distributed to fisherfolk in the nearby communities so they can grow the juveniles to maturity so that they can sell them. So abalone is very expensive and profit margins can be great. So this is a potential way to improve the livelihood of coastal communities. The problem is that production of abalone juveniles is fraught with some challenges. And that is what the WPU research team is trying to address through this project. They're working with Malampaya Foundation, which is a non-profit organization and has ties with the community and is coordinating with the barangays in Palawan to get them interested and involved in this project by growing out the juveniles generated by WPU. The WPU people will collect data from the participating fisher folk regarding their abalone cultures, which will help the WPU research team assess their abalone culture technology. So the next project is here from UPLB. It's from Dr. Sals' team in animal science. So this addresses the current issue in the Philippines where most of the cattle being imported to the Philippines are not really suitable to thrive in our conditions. So even if they might produce good milk or good meat abroad, they do not perform as well here because they are not adapted to the conditions here. So this project will characterize the native cattle stock here in the Philippines at the DNA level and identify those breeds that have good traits. Okay, the hope is to identify a good cattle stock that can then be crossed with other breeds, like the imported cattle, to ultimately produce breeds that will thrive under local conditions and produce good milk or good meat or whatever trait you're interested in. Their industry partner is Philippine Asian Biotech R&D Corporation, okay, which is already growing cattle and therefore is ready to adopt the results from this project and can also provide input as to the research strategy. Okay, Bohol Island State University is also involved in carrying out the research project. And the team is also collaborating with a faculty member from North Carolina State University who is an expert in genomics or genome analysis. So this is the type of project that STRIDE is encouraging, like more collaboration between and among many institutions. The next example comes from Iloilo Science and Technology University, formerly the Western Visayas College of Science and Technology. So they are collaborating with Unifish, which is a bait fish company in the Visayas region. So Unifish harvests a lot of silver banded whiting, a fish, type of fish, but discards the fish heads. So the project addresses the problem of what to do with the fish heads. The fish eyes are known to be a good source of hyaluronic acid. So the research team is asking the question, can you get hyaluronic acid from the eyes of silver banded whiting? It's asuhos in the native language. And can you make the process really economical? So hyaluronic acid has a lot of uses, for example, in cosmetic products and as health supplements to lubricate our joints. Okay, last example. This is in collaboration with Nutratech Biopharma Inc., which is a nutraceutical company here in the Philippines based in Cavite. So it's about Yakon. Have you heard of Yakon? Okay, so it's a plant that's mainly grown for its sweet-tasting tubers. Okay, the Yakon plant is a good source of nutraceuticals with antioxidant properties and prebiotics and fructooligosaccharides, which are good for diabetics and those who want to lose weight. So the idea is MSU IIT will design an evaporator which will enable the Yakon farmers to prepare a high-value product, which is a syrup that contains up to 50% fructooligosaccharides from Yakon roots. Okay, the industry partner, Nutratech Biopharma, will buy these intermediate products and process them further. Nutratech also will work with the farmers to teach them good manufacturing processes. There are now growing yakon in the Mindanao region, and it seems that yakon is growing there pretty well. So, in a nutshell, STRIDE aspires to foster a culture of innovation in the science and technology space here in the Philippines. They note that STRIDE is a USAID Office of Education initiative, which means that a significant number of STRIDE activities engage the academy. Okay, STRIDE hopes to promote innovative activity by encouraging collaborations between industry and academe, like in the examples that I showed you, and upgrade the research skills of faculty. And this is a major issue, as most universities, especially SOCs, state universities and colleges, started out as teaching colleges and therefore have a historical tradition grounded in instruction and not in research. And also improving the systems and processes supporting the university research activities and help shape national policy that will facilitate innovative activity. So in order to accomplish these objectives, in addition to the research grants, we do a lot of other activities. And some of these activities are listed here. So PGWIR stands for Philippine Government University Industry Research Roundtable. So it's a group of high-level officials from government, from industry, from academe, and we convene them in meetings where they can talk about issues that affect the research and technology, the science and technology research here in the Philippines. So by getting them all together in one space, they talk to each other, sound ideas of each other, and the hope is they could come up with a plan or an action plan that would address the problems that we have been able to identify. So one example is the procurement issue. I'm sure you're all familiar, or the faculty here are familiar with the difficulty of getting research equipment, research reagents. And so that's been identified by STRIDE as a major roadblock to do research effectively. And so that's one topic that's been addressed in PGWIR, and hopefully with more meetings and more research, we'll be able to come up with an action plan to address that challenge. The next activity is participatory institutional diagnostics. That's where we go to the different universities all over the Philippines and engage key officials in administration, in finance, in management, and then get them talking about how their processes affect the conduct of research in their institution. Because we all know that research does not happen in a vacuum. We know that there are support systems like procurement, like the Fees and Awards Committee, which are not really research directly related, but they affect how research is conducted in the university. So the hope is, with the participatory institutional diagnostics, we get a sense of the research process and the problems and the issues that plague the system, and then we would be able to design workshops, trainings, addressing those issues, and the AGIs would avail of those opportunities, and the hope is that with those interventions, we get to address the problems and the research process would proceed more effectively. Then we also conduct innovation workshops. This could be region-based or sector-based. You can suggest a topic that could be the focus of the innovation workshop. So in the innovation workshop, we bring together people from the academe, people from the industry, to talk about a particular interest, a particular sector, like abaca or bioenergy, biofuels. So the academe people will talk about their research expertise and their capabilities, and then the industry people will talk about the problems that they encounter in their operations. And by getting them together in one meeting, they'll be able to put their heads together and come up with a program, an idea to address the industry need using the expertise that can be borne to bear by the faculty. Then we also have the Learning and Innovation Networks. That's where we bring together people of similarly situated individuals from different universities, and they learn from each other. So for example, we established a Learning and Innovation Network among alumni relations directors with the premise that building the alumni relations of a university will be a good asset for that university in order to bring their alumni into the fold. Because alumni are a rich resource of expertise, of funds, and by bringing them, by having stronger relationships with alumni, the HEI might be able to improve their science and technology research. So the Learning and Innovation Network, we bring together people from different universities so they can share their experiences, their expertise, and they learn from each other. Because the paradigm before was that you bring in an expert and you learn from the expert, but with a Learning and Innovation Network, people within that network learn from each other based on their experiences and their expertise, and then together, by sharing, they come up with ideas and with an action plan to address a particular problem. So as you may appreciate, innovation is a complicated process. Innovation does not happen overnight. Okay, you might have a great idea, but usually it doesn't work as originally envisioned. You need to refine it, develop it further, and do a lot of experimentation. And this takes time, patience, and determination. Okay, for a great idea to finally bear fruit as innovation, the environment must be supportive of the innovative process, meaning you have the people with the right skills, you can get the materials you need pretty fast, research money is there, and the national laws and policies facilitate the research process and provide the necessary incentives. So this is just like my idea of what the innovation process can look like. So where does the idea come from? So you can have a network, or you could read from literature, or from your own experience, you can come up with an idea that would solve a particular problem. But that idea isn't gonna be successful in its first incarnation, right? So you have to do research in order to refine that idea. And from that research, it would be trial and error invariably, and that would give you more ideas, so that's the feedback loop, to refine the idea and make it more possible to succeed. And then from the research, you come up with a product or a technology that can be used by the consumer. But in order for that to be used, you still have to disseminate it, and you have to market it in the right way. And from one step to the next, you will generate ideas, and so there will be arrows feeding back to the idea stage in order to further refine and develop your ideas. So an example of how complex innovation can be is shown by the Post-it case. I'm not sure if you've seen this before, because I just got this from the internet. So the Post-it. So how a solution without a problem became the Post-it note. So you're familiar with the Post-it note, right? The Wasp speaking. So in 1968, Silver, who was a chemist at 3M, invented a glue that didn't stay stuck, okay? But he thought that there must be some way that the glue could be useful, even if it wasn't efficient in sticking. Okay, but for the life of him, he couldn't figure out how it would be useful. So he turned to his colleagues for help. So he spent 6 years, imagine 6 years, trying to figure out what the problem the glue would be the solution for. So another person, Arthur Fry, who was a product development at 3M, had a problem of his own. And so Fry sang in a church choir, and he hated how the paper bookmarks he used to mark hymns in the hymnal fell out of the book so easily. So in 1974, Fry attended a lecture Silver was giving on his Unsticky Blue. So Fry coated one of his bookmarks with Silver's glue. They stuck, but could be easily removed and reapplied. But it took another 6 years for Fry's somewhat sticky bookmarks to evolve into post-it notes. So the biggest problem was that 3M needed to figure out how to market a sticky note that didn't stay stuck. So in 1977, the product was introduced as Press and Peel. So it was a huge flop, because like this woman is saying, it doesn't stay stuck. So what's the point of buying the products? So Press and Peel was pulled, then introduced in 1980s as a post-it note in a campaign 3M called the Boise Blitz. So 3M gave away huge quantities of post-it notes in Boise, Idaho. And it worked. So when people saw the notes in use, they had to go out and buy them for themselves. So sales went through the roof. So it took more than a decade, but Silver's idea finally stuck. So the lessons learned here, I kind of put them in a list. So trust your instinct. So like the person who thought of the glue, he knew that there was a purpose for the glue, but he just didn't know what to use for. So he kind of stayed true to his guns and just determined to figure out finally what that use would be eventually. But even if it didn't come right there and then, immediately, he trusted his instinct. And then persevere, success is not achieved overnight. So as you saw there, it took a decade to get it finally marketed successfully. So seek others for advice, collaborate. So if we couldn't have identified the use if he didn't go out there and talk with other people. So that's another demonstration of how important collaboration is. And spread the word about your technology, and that's how he was able to get the use for the post-it note. And be creative, and how you market your product is important. Okay, so the issues and challenges that we have identified at Stride, like I mentioned, is procurement. So procurement is a big challenge. And the way that we're going to address that is we're going to the different universities trying to determine where exactly is the problem. But here in UPLB, you have UPLB-FI, which gets around the procurement issues to a certain degree. But where exactly in the law is the problem? Is it in the law, really, or the interpretation, or the implementing rules and regulations? So STRIDE is in the process of clarifying the situation, and will then take the necessary steps to address the issue. Another challenge is the translation of research. We should endeavor to translate research outputs into something tangible or something that is of economic use. I know that previously it was okay to do research for research's sake or to create knowledge, but if we are to create interest in science, technology, engineering, and math, or STEM, among more of the younger generation, we have to show them how much impact research can have. And one way to do that is to translate the research into technologies that improve our lives, or get us to know our world or ourselves a bit better, or at least show them that research has the potential of transforming our lives. And as you can see, the research funded by STRIDE is along those lines. The idea is for the STRIDE projects to really get translated into something tangible, or result in a product or a technology that responds to a market need. And we do need to create an interest in science among the younger generation, as there is not a lot of STEM majors here in the Philippines in the pipeline. So that's one of the challenges. So why is there no big number of people who want to go to STEM? So I think they don't see a STEM career as something that would be a great way to earn a living. They don't see STEM careers as exciting, or maybe they find it too technical or difficult. So to address this issue, I think we have to make a better effort to make science more fun at the primary school level and make a better effort in spreading the word about the importance and the impact a STEM career can potentially have. And success stories of Philippine science and Filipino scientists. So another issue is government funding. We can also do a better job in lobbying the government to spend more money in R&D. Okay, I don't have the numbers with me, but I think the Philippines spends a very minute portion of its budget to R&D compared to other countries. So spending more money in R&D should lead to better research equipment, more research output, and more STEM-related employment. This in turn would make more of the younger generations more interested in pursuing STEM careers. Of course, one reason why the government isn't putting a lot of money in S&T is perhaps it's not seeing a lot of return on investment on S&T. So it's a vicious cycle. So we have to do a better job in educating our politicians and policy makers. So I kind of like summarize that with this slide. So if you increase government and funding, if you increase science and technology government spending, you'd have more success stories. And if you have more success stories, then that would cause the government to put more money in S&T. But the problem is, how do you start that cycle going, right? How would you get more success stories if you don't have government spending? And how would you get government spending if you don't have any success stories in the first place? So that's a problem. But I think my hope though is that we have already a lot of research going on right now, and the challenge now is to put them together or package them in a way to sell to the government, to give them a real good case that, hey, science and technology is something that's a good investment and you really have to put more money in it. Okay, so let's about the things that I want to share, but just apply because I'm USAID. I'm USAID, so I want to let you know of an opportunity for grants. I don't know if you've seen this before, but it's peer grants, partnerships for enhanced engagement in research for the faculty here. So it's funded by USAID. It supports research collaborations between scientists from developing countries, including the Philippines, and U.S. government-funded researchers. So, kailangan may collaboration between researcher here and someone in the U.S. So, the deadline for pre-proposals is January 15 of 2016, so that's like really close. But I'm sure you still have time, kasi nga, patapos na naman yung klase. And then, people in the U.S. naman, they work all the time, so if you want to contact them to form a collaboration, I'm sure they'll respond. And they have to be submitted online. For more information, just go to our website or this website, which includes tips on how to find the U.S. collaborator. These are examples of agency partners, potential in the U.S. that you can collaborate with. Eligibility must be based at an academic institution, nonprofit organization, or government-managed research laboratory, center, or institute in a peer eligible country. So that's Philippines. So qualified. Okay. So eligible topics. Actually, yung peer grants is a call of many kinds. There are global calls for all of the countries or for different topics and regional and priority focused area calls. And the Philippine-based researchers are eligible for many of the calls. So one call is for proposals, is an open call, multiple research fields, in what topics, biodiversity, agriculture, so mga taga-IDB, so tama-tama, IB, sa science cluster din, agriculture. Disaster mitigation, so food security, water sanitation, urbanization, democracy and governance, education. And then another call that the Philippines is eligible for is the health implementation science. So if you have a science project relating to tuberculosis, maternal and child health, or a social science project relating to family planning, then this is the call for you. There's also a call for renewable energy and microgrids, and a call for rapid assessment of fish stocks in the South China Sea. And also for pelagic fish stocks in the Sulawesi Sea. So the pre-proposal should convey the developmental impact of the proposed research. It should include a clear statement of the project goals and explanation of the how the goals will be achieved and highlight how the collaboration with US partner will contribute to the success of the project. So you get that kind of pre-proposals on January 15th, then they will let you know if it's good enough by late February, at which time they will ask you to put together and submit a full-blown proposal, which should be due sometime in April. The details are in the website anyway, so you can look them up. So the proposal should also outline how the research findings will lead to development-related policy or programmatic change, and must also contribute to USAID higher education objectives by strengthening engagement with junior researchers and undergraduate students. The budget request should be developed according to the support needed to implement the project goals. So the budget is included in the pre-proposal. Okay? And the duration of the project is 1 to 3 years. So single institution awards are anticipated to be $40,000 to $80,000 per year for 1 to 3 years. And if it's a multiple institution proposal, meaning the proposal involves more than one institution here in the Philippines, the budget can range from $80,000 to $100,000 per year for up to 3 years. So going back to innovation originality, I live in Makati, so there was a time where they had these posters in the underpass. So there, this is about the Ayala Museum, so it's not really exactly about science and technology, but if you read about it, they might as well apply it to how do you gain originality in the science and technology space. So here, how do you inspire originality? Don't be afraid, sing your own tune. How do you inspire innovation? Do things differently. And how do you inspire, how do you inspire creativity? Be curious, be fearless, be authentic. So those are things that, you know, hopefully will inspire you to be innovative and not to just follow anyone's career path or, you know, forge your own path and think differently and be innovative. Thank you.